Okay, let's start. I'm going to put this thing here because apparently I need to do the introduction at the level at which people can record it in the back. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Raul Jimenez from the University of Barcelona, who will talk about fundamental physics and cosmology on a very special today, special day today, with the announcement of the discovery of the gravitational waves from inflation. So that would be something that you will touch upon.
Yes.
Professor Jimenez got his undergraduate degree in Madrid in theoretical physics, and he did a PhD at the Niels Bohr Institute in Copenhagen, basically on precision cosmology and the age of the universe. That was his PhD work. Then he was a postdoc at the University of Edinburgh in Scotland for 5 years before he became an assistant professor at Rutgers University. And after about 2 years, he got tenure and moved to the University of Pennsylvania, where he was there until 7 years ago, where he moved and now has the chair of cosmology at the University of Barcelona.
Well, so thank you very much, Sabas, for the invitation. It is a pleasure to be here, Brown Physics, and it is especially exciting to talk about cosmology today, now that there has been a big announcement about the detection of gravitational waves, primordial gravitational waves, from the inflationary epoch. So the announcement was made this morning at about 11 a.m. I have modified a bit my talk so I can incorporate the news about the announcement. I will discuss the announcement, I will discuss what it means, and basically that means that maybe I'm not able to talk about all the subjects I wanted to talk about in my colloquium, but since this is actually quite interesting and exciting, I think it is worth spending some time discussing this issue. So what I'm going to tell you about for the next 45 minutes or so is about how we exploit the sky, the universe, to test our fundamental laws of physics, and more interesting, to learn about the fundamental laws of physics. So I'm going to be discussing inflation properties, that is the initial conditions for the universe. I will be discussing how these initial conditions get in place. I will then tell you about how we can shed light on one of the most interesting questions in particle physics today, which is about the neutrino, or the mass origin for neutrinos. I will then move on about the subject of dark energy, that was the discovery from about 10 years ago about the fact that our universe is microinflating today, so we are living the second phase of inflation. And then I was going to tell you something about how to find axions, so beyond the standard physics model, using astronomical observations. Most likely I'm not going to get here, but I'm more than happy to talk to anybody afterwards about this issue. So first, a warning, and to put everything in context. In cosmology and astronomy, we do not do experiments. We only do observations. Now, you may think this is a disaster because you are only there to be able to observe things. And also, you may even think it is more of a disaster because you are only going to make model-dependent statements. However, there is also a blessing to this fact because you can actually go and observe the whole universe at once. Because the universe, basically, the way we obtain information, I'm not talking about cosmology, I'm not talking about, you know, exoplanets, finding planets or something like that. I'm talking here about cosmology. Because we are extracting information from a stochastic variable, from a random variable, you are limited by the size of the universe about how much information you can infer from that stochastic variable. That's what we call cosmic variance in cosmology. And therefore, there is so much information you can extract from the sky. Because of that, you have to be careful what data you choose to infer your conclusions. In the sense, you do not want to infer conclusions from extremely complicated processes that are going to be masquerading the fundamental physics. Having said that, let's put the thing in context. 20 years ago, when I started my PhD in Copenhagen, this was the situation in cosmology. We had collected positions and distances, redshifts, of galaxies for about a few thousand. This is the CFA survey, and this is us, and I'm just plotting here distance from us and position, angular position in the sky. And the measurement of the fluctuations of the cosmic microwave background from COBE were just announced. Something for the young people, something very interesting to note here. Now, the galaxies were given to researchers printed on paper sheets, right? So no file, no electronic format, you were just reading it from the paper. Second, the signal to noise, these are hot spots or cold spots in the sky. Those are, now we know, and at that time we believe, fluctuations in the potential field of the primordial fluctuations. The signal to noise here per pixel is 1, okay? And at that time, most physicists besides cosmologists were completely convinced that this was a noise map and that this was going to be to go away. Now, that hasn't happened, but I think it is interesting to put this in place because 20 years ago, we were discovering fluctuations in the temperature in the scalar. Now, we have allegedly discovered the fluctuations in the polarization of those photons coming from the CMB. If you move forward 20 years, then you have this map, which probably I took for W map, but it doesn't matter. The Planck one looks exactly the same, or mostly the same, which is the high-resolution version of the previous map I showed you, this one here. But this map in the temperature has extracted all the information in the sky. That map is limited by the stochasticity in the variables, in the temperature fluctuations. There is no need for any graduate students ever again in the history of mankind to go and repeat this experiment. It is done. End of the story. Temperature of the CMB doesn't need to be measured again, at least in the large scales. For the primary results, I will discuss what that is in cosmology. At the same time, we are trying. So the cosmic microwave background is basically the point when protons and electrons recombinated. They formed hydrogen, and then the photons were able to escape to us. The universe became transparent. Now, that's a slice in the history of the universe. All the way up to us here, there is a lot of volume that it is filled up by galaxies and other things in the universe. What we are doing now is to try to map out every single position of galaxies, gas, or whatever, from here, our position, all the way back to the cosmic microwave background. We are trying to pick up all the information in the sky between us and the CMB. Now, before this morning, I would have stopped here in this talk and told you, well, that's what we are doing. Let's keep working on this and extract information. Now, it happens that now what we have done is actually extract information between the CMB, a few hundred thousand years after the Big Bang, and all the way down to 10 to the minus 34 seconds, which is the time at which tensor fluctuations in the metric at the time the universe was 10 to the minus 34 seconds old were created and they were transmitted into a polarization signal, which I will explain what it is. So basically, we seem to have a picture between 10 to the minus 34 seconds all the way down to us in cosmology. And I think that's the thing that is making this field so exciting, because from 20 years to now, we have been going from not having a real measurement of how the primordial universe looked like to actually having a very clear picture of how the universe is at a scale close to the Planck mass. As I will show you in a second, the recent discovery from this morning tells us that there must be physics taking place at the Planck scale, which was very unexpected. Until this morning, the only proof we had is that we had physics at the scale of the MeV, the atoms, nucleosynthesis, hydrogen, helium, in the universe. Now, when you collect so many data, you have to be very careful about systematic errors. So I like to point people to this beautiful fresco in Florence, where you see this wonderful heaven full of angels and everything is wonderful, but you tend to forget about hell. Hell is full of creatures that contaminate your data, that make you believe that things are the way they are not. Be very careful, and I will tell you a story about the cosmic background that happened 25 years ago, that made people very excited and turned out not to be correct because of systematic errors. So what have we learned already about the universe? So Greg Tucker was a great player on the WMAP experiment, and this plot comes out from the first paper they published in their data release. In my opinion, it's a great breakthrough of cosmology. It shows that primordial fluctuations had to be super horizon. It is a proof, and I'm going to explain to you why. What this plot shows you is that it's plotting here the power spectrum of the modes you have in the sky in the between is the cross power spectrum between temperature and polarization. It's one of the Stokes parameters in the polarization. Versus a scale, okay? We like to take the sky and break it into spherical harmonics. So this is the scale. And basically here you have about 1 degree, so this is about a few degrees in the sky. Now, if the fluctuations are sourced by the gradient, then that polarization, you can do the calculation, I'm not going to do it here, it's just mathematics, should be anti-correlated. The larger the scale, the smaller the scale, the smaller the correlation. That's exactly what you see here. This is the model where you have casual seeds. Again, the old people will remember that the most popular model to actually make a structure in the universe was to have cosmic defects. Those are casually connected defects in phase transitions. Well, you don't need any statistics to see that the data are here and not there. So this was the first proof that we have super horizon fluctuations. And I think that it hasn't got enough credit as it should, because I think it is pretty remarkable. The other thing that we have known is the following. The fluctuations that you see in the sky are nearly Gaussian. And I will tell you in 3 slides about what this parameter means and what this number. But just keep in mind, but what we have learned from the CMB is that the fluctuations are nearly Gaussian. That is, in Fourier space, you have decoupled modes, which is exactly what inflation will predict. We have also learned that the power spectrum of the scalar fluctuation is nearly scale invariant. It doesn't matter at which scale you are going to generate the same amount of fluctuation. So for the Wilsonian people, that should be the way the universe should look like, no preferred scales. But there is a tiny deviation from a scale invariant. This number is not 1, it's slightly smaller than 1. And that's exactly what inflation will predict, that you are not exactly a scale invariant, you have a little deviation. The reason for that is that you need to get out of inflation, right? Inflation is an exponential accelerated phase in the metric. And if you are accelerating out everything out of your horizon, of course you have an empty universe. Since we are here, that's an experimental fact, at some point inflation must have stopped. And that's the reason you have this deviation. The other interesting thing is that we have also proven that we have adiabatic initial conditions, that we didn't have any entropy being dumped at the beginning of the universe into the fluctuations, that we have these conditions. And finally, what I started with, that we have super horizon fluctuations. The other thing that we have learned, actually, is that the universe is flat. But we have learned that from other data sets. So I will come back to that later on during my talk. Now the excitement. This goes back to Starobinsky, 79, who predicted that if you had an early period of inflation, you should generate tensor modes, that is fluctuations of the metric. If you generate tensor modes, fluctuations of the metrics, what you do is to imprint a quadrupole moment in those density fluctuations, right? So now you are going to have hot, hot, cold, cold spots in temperature, right? Because, of course, a density fluctuation, when the photon goes through, is going to see either a valley or a mountain. And if you have a quadrupole moment and you have Thomson scattering, immediately you are going to generate polarization. So you can actually calculate that if you have that imprint on the metric, then you should have a polarization model and polarization pattern imprinted in the temperature. That polarization pattern, if you break it in component, should have a divergence-free and curl-free component. The one of interest is the one that has curl. The one that has curl is the one that is being generated by the fluctuations, the tensor fluctuations in the metric. So cosmologists like to plot that, like a figure of merit of that fluctuation, with the number R. R is simply the ratio of scalar perturbations to metric perturbations. So scalar perturbations are vacuum fluctuations in the field that was the inflaton that accelerated the universe. Tensor perturbations are perturbations in the metric itself. Okay, that's why they are so exciting. It's also good to make this plot as a function of how much the field, the inflaton that expanded the universe, move in units of the Planck mass. So there is a relation that all these inflationary models should follow. They should be on this straight line. And therefore, if you have a detection of this number, then immediately you know how much the field has moved. So there was a clear target. On the right, the field is transplanckian. On the left, the field is subplanckian. Further, this axis here is actually an energy scale. So the higher up you are, the higher the energy. So let me give you two numbers for you to remember. 0.1 here is about 3 times 10 to the 16 GeVs. So take that to the fourth, that will be the energy density at which inflation took place. And then you keep going down, right? So this is actually the contrary to an accelerator. The lower R, the lower the energy you are. So any measurement you make on this plane will automatically tell you, A, that tensor fluctuations in the metric took place at that epoch of inflation, and B, what are the conditions of the potential or the field that generated that inflation epoch. There is also one very interesting thing that inflation predicts, and I will tell you a bit about this, is that the same way we look at the scale dependence of scalar perturbations, that is the temperature fluctuations that we look at in the sky, you can also look at the scale dependent of the tensor perturbations, right? And then inflation tells you that if that's the case, that number, so you take this perturbations to be like a power law, and you look at what is this index of that power law, should be 8 times the value of R, where R is the amount of tensors you have in your perturbations. So that's a prediction of inflation. You should be there. Now, the excitement this morning was because of the following. The excitement was because there is actually a detection of those tensor modes. An experiment called biceps/Keck array based at the South Pole. It is an array of telescopes that has instruments sensitive enough to detect polarization of the temperature fluctuations in the CMB, has been observing the sky, a patch of the sky in the South Pole. And today what they release is that they claim they have a measurement of those primordial tensor modes. So let me explain a bit what they have said. Before I do that, let me show you what the status was until this morning. The Planck satellite, which was the European satellite that measured the polarization, the temperature in the whole sky, put constraints on this R tensor to scalar ratio as a function of the primordial tilt of the spectral index of scalar fluctuations. This is called NS here. And these were the 1 sigma and the 2 sigma constraints. So they only had an upper limit, and they claimed that limit was up to about 0.15, 0.2. So they couldn't make a detection. They only said we have an upper limit. Now you look back at this plot and you put here 0.2, you see that that will mean that the field has moved about 3-4 Planck masses. So you have a transplanckian field still. And here they plot several models of inflation, whichever is your favorite. The only thing I'm going to note is one thing. This model right here is a phi square model. It's a harmonic oscillator for the potential of the inflaton. Okay. Now, the device of collaboration is claiming a detection. They claim that they have measured this number. It is 0.2 plus or minus 0.05. 1 sigma contours, 2 sigma contours. This red contour here is the one you have here extended. I will not talk about the technicality, but we can discuss that. 1 sigma, 2 sigma from Planck. So they say Planck, what this means here is they say, let's take Planck polarization from WMAP. And here they say, let's take all those plus the Bicep experiment, and that's the result you get. Now, how do they get this result? Well, the only thing they do is very simple. They look at the sky. They measure the polarization vector at every single pixel. They compute the one of the stock parameter combinations, and they compute the power spectrum. This is the power spectrum as a function of a scale. Again, here you have 1 degree. Here you have about 5 degrees. This is the theoretical prediction for inflation for that power spectrum from the primordial tensor modes. And what they claim is that they have measured it with these points. If that's the case, then this is the result when you put it in that plane. Now, why is that interesting? Well, it's interesting for several reasons. First, is the first window into the early universe. We have now managed to go beyond the CMB and have managed to go all the way down to when the perturbations were generated. Second, you are looking at fluctuations in the metric at a time when the universe was 10 to the minus 34 seconds old. Third, if you look at the scale of that number in terms of energy of inflation, 0.2 will mean that the scale of inflation, that is how, so, sorry about that. So you have a potential. Now we know what kind it is. Of it is this, right? You have here a field, phi, that is rolling down that potential. And of course, you know that that field, you can write it down like a perfect fluid, if you wish, with equation of a state W. If you write it down like P is equal to minus rho, that is that you have the pressure, kinetic minus potential energy, and the air density like K plus potential energy, the only way to make this equal P to minus rho is to actually kill the potential, the kinetic energy from here. That's why you call it a slow rolling field. Now, when you have this equation of a state, you do know that if you put it back into Freeman equation, then your metric, the A of t expansion on the metric, well, I'm looking at the proper time and the proper distance, will look something like E to the ht, where h is the Hubble parameter at that time, how fast. And this will be a constant. So just by the fact that you have pressure equal to minus density, you are going to expand exponentially the metric. Okay? Now, this energy is when inflation started. Now we know it's of the order of 10 to the 16, 10 to the 17 GeVs. Okay? So 1% to 10% of the Planck energy density. So I think this is the first experimental measurement that there is physics at nearly the Planck scale. So very exciting for our quantum gravity friends, I believe. And in fact, inflation was motivated. The very first model I know of is the one of Starobinsky, where he was doing quantum corrections to Einstein gravity. It was an R plus R squared model. The other interesting thing is that from this graph, the field must have moved at least three Planck masses. So if I go back to my plot, between here and here, which is what I need to make the universe as large as I see it now, the field has moved 3 m Planck. So the field needs to be transplanckian. And that should be a feature of physics beyond the Planck scale. So, where are we? Well, let's not get too excited. This is the first measurement by one team. We need to look at the systematics. We need to understand if this will hold. The reason I'm telling you this is because 25 years ago, there was something called the Berkeley-Nagoya excitement. What happened is that some scientists launched a rocket. They measured the temperature of the CMB, and they thought they had discovered that it was not a black body, but it deviated from a black body. And then, I didn't plot it here, but you cannot imagine the number of theoretical models that came up to describe the Big Bang and with alternatives to the Big Bang, blah, blah, blah. At the end, it turned out to be a systematic in their experiment. And that went away, and now we know, after COVID flu, that the CMB is actually a black body. In fact, the best black body we have ever measured in the laboratory. Same thing here, right? There are some things I'm going to point out. Why are these points much higher than the line where they should be? Well, that's something that they will have to tell us and see what happens, right? Now, the very good news is that if the signal is so large as this, other experiments, like IBEX, the one that Greg is leading here, should be able to tell us within a year or two. So within a year or two, we should have here confirmation or ruling out by at least another two or three experiments. So the thing will be answered and closed, I believe, in a couple of years. 1 or 2 years, we will be looking at this. And we will show you the map of the CMB the same way we look at the map 20 years ago. If this holds, and really the signal here is real, and the inflaton inflated at such a large energy scale, then I think we are out for a very exciting period in cosmology. Because then we can measure the scale of the power spectrum of the tensor modes. I mean, do understand that if this is true, you are looking directly at quasi-de Sitter perturbations sitting there on the field. You are basically doing experiments on the Sitter, if you wish. It is very, very exciting. And we can predict exactly the signal that direct gravitational wave detector should see. So now you can go and put an experiment in space because the frequency at which these waves, the gravitational waves, are generated is very small, 10 to the minus 3 hertz usually. You can now go put an experiment in space and measure the gravitational waves directly. And then you are measuring those waves from the early universe directly. So pretty exciting, this new window that has opened. All I have to say about the excitement from this morning, I think it's just a golden epoch for cosmology that keeps going on. I thought it was when I started 20 years ago, but it seems that 20 years after, it is even more interesting than that. Let me tell you about another golden epoch that I think could be opening very soon and can be very, very exciting. So I said that the inflationary period predicts that fluctuation should be Gaussian. Why do I say this? Well, So what is inflation? You can think about inflation the following way. You are stretching the metric exponentially, but you keep the horizon fixed. The horizon is h. So basically, every perturbation you generate goes out of the horizon. And then the next one goes out of the horizon, this one. Out of the horizon, the fluctuations are frozen, because of course they cannot talk to each other. They are outside the horizon, the casual horizon. At some point, inflation stops, and then your horizon grows. And then the fluctuations start to enter into the horizon, and then they interact with each other. This is true for a perfect de Sitter field, where each fluctuation doesn't talk to each other. But nothing is perfect in this life. When you have the field that it is slightly twisted, the field is going to have some self-interaction. Very small, but some self-interaction. What that means is that those fluctuations talk to each other. And when they talk to each other, you are going to deviate slightly from the Gaussian prediction. And that's what we call the non-Gaussianity, right? And usually people write down the deviation from non-Gaussianity as a Taylor expansion, right? They say, okay, I have the Gaussian field plus a correction that goes like phi squared, and I'm going to call that my real fluctuation. Now, how much this coefficient, that you can take it as a constant or you can make it dependent on something, on time, deviates from zero is telling you about the Lagrangian of the inflaton. Basically, by measuring these correlators, because that's what you are measuring the three-point function, the four-point function, the five-point function, all these things, you can actually then go back and reconstruct the Lagrangian of inflation. So you look at it as an effective field theory, you can keep adding things to that Lagrangian. So by measuring this, I can actually go back to you and tell you, look, this is the Lagrangian that was taking place for the field on the sitter at that time. And now I know, if that detection is correct, that it will be at near Planckian energies. The only thing I want to say here, you don't need to read the view graph, it's a bit technical, is that that parameter, FNL here, the non-Gaussian parameter, is related to the potential of the inflaton. So you can reconstruct the first derivative, the second derivative, and so on by measuring this non-Gaussianity. And that's why it is exciting. You can reconstruct the thing. One thing I want to point out, unlike in the tensor modes that we didn't know what the value was because there is no prediction for inflation, for inflation, there is a minimum value you can have, and that's the value of the tilt of the spectral scalar perturbation spectrum. So you take the scalar perturbation spectrum, you compute how much it deviates from a power law, and that's what it should be. So it should be at least a few 10%. Now, understand this is a very difficult measurement because you have heard that the temperature fluctuations, the ones that Kobe measure, are a part in 10 to the 5. So put here 10 to the minus 5. This is 10 to the minus 10. If you put here 0.04, you're trying to measure 10 to the minus 7 compared to this. It's a very, very tiny amount that you are trying to measure. But of course, you have the whole sky. Right? You have billions of pixels. So it is something that you can play with. You have many modes in your Fourier space if you want to do it. Now, so what is the situation in that field? Well, the situation is a bit less exciting than in the tensor modes because we have not made a detection of non-Gaussianity yet, but we have put upper limits. So first, WMAP put some upper limit, and now Planck has said that the non-Gaussianity cannot be larger than around 10. Remember, the limit is 0.04 for a particular inflation model. You can have other kind of inflation models that generate a lot of non-Gaussianity. If you have two fields that are driving inflation, they talk to each other, they have a coupling constant, and then immediately you generate very large numbers. So at least we have learned a lot. It seems that we are basically driven to the simplest inflationary model. The simplest one, consistent with the detection today, is a phi square, which is a harmonic oscillator. So you are a bit cynical. You can say the universe is nothing but a harmonic oscillator. Now, what I want to point out here is the following, and this is something because of interest to me, because this is what the CMB has explored, but of course you can measure the non-Gaussian distribution also in the distribution of galaxies and clusters. And there we do not have a good measurement yet. In fact, one of the most exciting things that I can think about is the LSST project. Jan is working on that very hard. That can get you all the way down to about 0.5 or something like that in this number, something here. They are getting very close to even the inflation limit. But that's not the reason I want to tell you about that number. I want to tell you about that number because it is even more exciting than you think. Let me just say, I will flash some work that we did to actually do this calculation exact, because you actually need to compute the PDF exactly, and that's something that we did together. The most exciting thing is the following. Because you see the horizon when you are looking at the universe, it is not anymore Newtonian gravity. It becomes GR gravity. When you have GR, the Poisson equation is not anymore the Poisson equation, but you have a correction. That correction can be reinterpreted as a non-Gaussian term in the equation. And that non-Gaussian term has a value of about order 1. Now 1 is twice than what the LSST people can measure. So LSST is a telescope taking place in Chile that is going to map out positions for galaxies, but also is going to do gravitational lensing, and therefore you're going to get a very good measurement of what the matter power spectrum is. Now, that signal has a very characteristic scale dependence. So this is a scale in the sky. This is the horizon. This is us. That signal should be able to be measured by the LSST. And if it does, then now we have a confirmation of GR at 10 to the 27 meters. I think you have to remember we are extrapolating GR from the solar system experiments all the way out to the horizon. So we are taking GR that works at 10 to the 13 meters and getting it all the way to work at 10 to the 27 meters. That's 14 orders of magnitude extrapolation in the theory. And I don't think we have done that with any other theory in physics. We are taking it for granted that it is good, but we have never tested it. And what is going to happen here is that we are going to be able to test it. So LSST may see first light in 2020, 5 years, 6 years. Let's be optimistic and call it 2025. I should be able to come back to Brown and put points here. Okay? And tell you where we are. Of course, the most exciting thing will be if GR was wrong. That would be amazing. But maybe it's right, and that's it. But then we have closed it, right? That's it. To the largest scales in the universe, we know that GR works. It works from the millimeter scale all the way up, or sub-millimeter now, so that people are doing these torsion experiments, all the way up to 10 to the 27 meters. Amazing. Okay, as I knew I was going to maybe cover half of my talk with the new excitement, but at least let me talk about another exciting field that I think cosmology can give answers very quickly. I'm talking about a question of years from now, maybe 3, 5, 10. So one of the most fundamental questions now that we have the standard model in place is what gives mass to the neutrinos? So what is the mechanism that is generating mass for the neutrinos, right? You know that the neutrinos should have zero mass according to all symmetries in the standard model. But unfortunately, they have mass. So something must have given them mass. And then people speculate with this beyond the standard model or so. Now, I like to recast this question in this form. Are neutrinos Dirac or Majorana? In other words, are neutrinos their own antiparticle, like Majorana, or do we have another family of neutrinos that are the antiparticles of the neutrinos? Can we answer that question? I mean, I don't have the answer now, but I will tell you how to answer the question in a few years with the sky. So let's try to remember something. So what is a neutrino for a cosmologist? For me, a neutrino is just radiation, right? It's radiation that eventually decouples and becomes non-relativistic and they behave like matter. Okay. Has small interactions, and it is hot because it is moving too fast. And that's key to understand its role in cosmology. So again, some reminding facts about neutrinos. Now, neutrinos come from the Big Bang, right? They decouple at about MeV energies, and they are hitting us as we speak. Only very few of them, right? About 100 comes from the Big Bang. Most of the neutrinos that we see passing through our bodies are actually from the sun. In principle, you could detect those neutrinos the same way you do with the photons from the CMB. It is the cosmic neutrino background. So if you have a good experiment, you could detect them. Now, unfortunately, the only way to detect them I know of is the Stokowski effect. It's just to look at the torsion that these neutrinos produce on a detector. And that's way beyond the current technology. So no hope to detect directly neutrinos from the Big Bang. We have to detect them. We have to use them in an indirect way to actually see what they are. Now, for the aficionados, if you want to figure out what this is the abundance, and this is the temperature, and the number of these neutrinos that we have in the sky, I'm not going to talk about that. I want to talk about how to use them in cosmology. And I want to do that because we have very recent developments. There are new data arriving from the CMB and from the position of galaxies. And also, we have made a breakthrough in modeling how these neutrinos affect the structure of the universe. So let me be concrete and tell you why we like these neutrinos. It is extremely simple, the thing that I want to measure. So imagine that my universe was having a lot of neutrinos as part of the dark matter. So to make things concrete, imagine I have a universe with colder matter. That's matter that doesn't move. It is the one that Sabas is going to find in a few years. And neutrinos, that's hot dark matter. That's matter that moves very fast, right? So I create a potential way. I have a perturbations like the ones I have measured in the CMB this morning. And that potential well is made of colder matter, is sitting there, and neutrinos that are moving here. Now, because neutrinos have a free streaming velocity, as time passes, they are going to move out of the potential. So that potential is going to have less dark matter than if it was made all of colder matter. And therefore, that potential is going to be shallower. If the potential is shallower, what you are doing is erasing structures in the universe and then getting rid of them. So by eye, your universe is going to look smoother if there is a lot of neutrinos. That means that they have a lot of mass. So this is what I'm showing you here. If you in the real computation, if you computed the power spectrum as a function of a scale, again, this is the horizon, we are here. This is basically a galaxy scale. One is the one that I have no neutrinos. It's pure colder matter. The dark matter is cold, it doesn't move, so when it goes into the potential well, it stays there. The potential well doesn't change. Now, if I have a particle that has one eV, the neutrinos, the sum of all the neutrino families have one eV, then it will depress the power spectrum, it will depress the amount of structure I have in the sky by about 50%. So you see, it is a huge effect. Even one eV in the neutrino mass is going to have the amount of power you have in the sky. That's why we are so good in cosmology at constraining the neutrino mass. But of course there is more, and we should be more ambitious. Neutrinos come in families, right? They have flavor. And therefore, we know we have three of them. And therefore you can arrange them in different ways. You can make these hierarchies, right? You put the highest neutrino here, and the lightest ones here, or the most massive ones here, and one lighter. These are called the different hierarchies. Now, the way you do that is because from the solar and the atmospheric experiments, from the oscillations, we do know what is the mass split, right? And that's the reason we know we have neutrinos have masses. So because you know the mass split, then, and you do not know the absolute mass scale, you can arrange them in different things, in different ways. So, what can we say about neutrinos in cosmology? Well, one nice way to do this is to make this plot. Well, what I'm doing here is to show you the lightest neutrino here versus the total mass. And the only place where you can be is here, the inverted hierarchy, the degenerate one, or the normal hierarchy, right? Now remember, you are also trying to arrange these things on flavor, right? So you have the total mass and the flavor of the neutrinos. Cosmology is actually giving a limit to the total mass. We do not have a detection. And that limit is about here, 0.2, 0.3 EVs. So we are already excluding the degenerate hierarchy. I'm going to tell you more about this. So our friends in the ground are doing these experiments, the direct experiments for detection of the neutrino masses, looking at the single beta tritium decay. And this is the Catrin experiment, now being put in place in Germany. And that experiment has a sensitivity of about 0.3, 0.35 electron volts. So we in cosmology are already below that limit, or about to be below that limit. Actually, to be concrete, the excitement from the last few months was that when we use all the data in the sky available to us, we can limit the mass of the neutrino to be smaller than 0.23. So the total sum of neutrino masses should not be much larger than this. And we are starting to inch into the territory of the hierarchies. So to be concrete, we have already put a limit on the total mass of the neutrinos. They are 0.23. This is what Catrin will measure in the future. They are assembling the experiment now, so in a few years we should have a measurement from them or an upper limit. And basically here is where cosmology is, a little bit lower than here. We have thrown out the degenerate hierarchy, and we seem to be left only with the inverted or the normal. Again, with LSST, you can actually go down all the way to a sensitivity in the neutrino mass of 0.05. The oscillations, the atmospheric oscillations, tell you that the mass, the delta mass, is 0.054. So therefore, the mass cannot be lower than that, right? Because delta m is that, so it cannot be lower than that. So we know that at least it is here. So we are going to have enough sensitivity to inch into the hierarchies and figure out how the hierarchies are. And I want to say two words about that before I wrap up and finish. So I will not talk about the nonlinearities. I just simply want to tell you that with the nonlinearities you can get more signal. But the thing here is the following. I want to be more ambitious and not only measure the total mass, I want to measure the individual masses of each of the families. The way I do this is because since neutrinos have different masses, they will decouple, they will become non-relativistic at different redshifts. Therefore, remember, neutrinos are radiation for a cosmologist, so they will change the matter-radiation equality, each of them at a different redshift, and that's what I'm going to be able to measure. Basically, in this plot, I'm going to be able to measure delta. This coefficient is defined as this. This is the largest mass minus the smallest mass divided by the total mass versus the total mass. So I am here, actually, and I want to measure a point here or there. I want to tell you whether or not it's inverted or normal hierarchy. I cannot do it today because I don't have the means, but in a few years, I should be able to do that. So let me come to this plot. It will be the last plot I talk about before concluding. Because I want to sort of tease you a bit. I want to actually make you believe that cosmology can measure flavor, although it cannot. So it's a kind of quiz for you. I want to answer the question in cosmology whether or not the particles, the neutrinos, are Majorana or Dirac. Now, how do physicists answer that question? Well, they take a lot of xenon, they put it in the ground in a mine, isolated from the cosmic rays, and they look and see if there is a neutrino-less double beta decay, right? If that's the case, then you have a Majorana, because then the particle is the same as the antiparticle, and then it can go into a double beta decay. Well, imagine that's the case. Then I have nothing else to say. They have discovered it. It's a Majorana. They win the Nobel Prize. Happy people. The situation now is that they have not discovered it. Okay? Now, is it because the particle is Majorana, but they need 10,000 tons of xenon? Or is it because it is Dirac? Well, then I can say something, because then they have not discovered it, right? And then I go to a regime that the mass of the neutrinos is something like this, 0.1 to 0.15. That's basically what we are in cosmology, even here, right? Don't look at this one. Then I determine that variable called delta from the sky. And then I make a decision. If it is here, it's degenerate. If it is here, it's inverted. And therefore, the only way you can have a hierarchy in that way is because the neutrinos are Dirac. So already, before my friends doing the double beta decay tell me what it is, I could actually discover the nature of the neutrinos. And in fact, I could go and tell you what is the origin of mass for this thing. You have a kind of seesaw, you have some kind of a Higgs mechanism similar to that to actually give mass to these particles. Unfortunately, I do not have a result that, but I'm hoping that again in a few years I can come back to Brown and tell you what neutrinos are. So let me jump to the conclusions, because it is late, and certainly I did have many more exciting things to tell you about, but the news today, we were overtaken by, sorry, that's not, those are my kids, sorry about that. So what is the summary of the talk today, or I wanted to tell you? Well, I wanted to tell you that there is a gigantic amount of data that we have in the sky. That gigantic amount of data can be mined, and all the information can be extracted. The universe has information now we know about all energy scales, or certainly goes all the way up to the Planck scale. And that's exciting, because you can say things about neutrinos that have sub-EB or EB masses all the way up to energies around 10 to the 18 GeVs. That's a gigantic number of orders of magnitude, actually, to be concrete, about order 30. And that's exciting, that you can explore 30 orders of magnitude in energy scale with the universe today, not in 1,000 years, today. I have given you some examples. Very exciting, the detector of tensor modes today, but also other things that are happening, like non-Gaussianities, neutrino masses, and a good chance for sure to measure the neutrino mass and the hierarchy. That will be very exciting, because then we can start to see how things go beyond the standard model. I want to say just one word before I finish, that one exciting thing that I haven't touched upon here is the nature of dark matter. So people like Sabas that are trying to figure out what the dark matter is and how to find it should have here a relevant role in saying what the other clue beyond the standard model is going to be. So whenever we find the dark matter, I think it's going to be terribly exciting to put together our model of fundamental physics. So I'll stop here and take questions. Thank you. In the sense that, no, yes, so, no, yeah, it's a deductive. So you can actually measure the equation of a state, because I can put W here as a free parameter, and that W is actually the first slow roll parameter, which is actually the first derivative of the inflaton potential over the inflaton potential. Now, until this morning, we had no idea about what that number was. Now we can actually, I can actually tell you what that number is. And actually, I can also tell you what this number is. It's about 10 to the minus 3. So now I can measure this. And I say that again.
It's a
Yes, exactly. It is like, sorry, this is 1 plus or 1 minus epsilon. You understand? I'm trying to make this equal to minus 1, so this must be minus 1 plus epsilon. You understand? It is a very lucky day, if true. Let's be careful and wait for a bit until other experiments confirm this detection. That would be my home take, that I think it's good to be excited, but I would like to see other independent experimentalists looking at this, looking at the gory details. These are complicated things, right? You are measuring a very tiny signal through foregrounds. You are looking it through the dust of the galaxy. You are looking it through synchrotron radiation. It is a very complicated thing. This is not trivial by any means. So I would like to see other people to look at it, see what it is. If three measurements come to the same result, all those guys go to Stockholm and get their Swedish gold. Until that, let's see what happens.
Any other questions?
Bob? Would you say that the cosmological limit of the 95% confidence level of less than 0.23 eV would rule out at that same level the sterile neutrino?
I think so, actually at the same level. I didn't show you the plot, let me put it up, because I had that discussion, I didn't have time to discuss it, because we already have constraints on the stellar neutrino. So let me show you that, let me put up the plot for a second, because that's a very interesting point that you make. So this is the constraint on stellar neutrinos, and in my view, stellar neutrinos are already ruled out. So 3.1 is from cosmology, that's because they detach at different ratios, so 3, right? And the limit here at 95% is it has to be smaller than 4 and larger than 2.8. So one stellar neutrino rule out, a half not. So you will need fractional radiation. You can do that with axions if you prefer, right? So if you like axions, then you can make half of a stellar neutrino with that. So the constraint now is a bit tighter than this that I'm showing you here. Is the number from the Planck team is 3.2 plus or minus 0.3. So you are there. So if you want to look at stellar neutrinos, they cannot be plus 1. They are ruled out. But the axions are in. You like axions that create like a half radiation or something like, you know, they count like half a particle. They could be detected. That's another exciting thing that I was going to talk at the end of my talk, that imagine that you measure here 3.5 plus or minus 0.1. Then you have an axion, because then you have extra radiation floating in the universe. And then there are other ways that you can use cosmology to look for the axions.
Could I ask another question about
neutrinos? Does anybody object?
Go ahead.
If I understood your chart of distinguishing between Majorana and Dirac.
Yes.
So what I'm learning from that is that you could establish that it's a Dirac. It is a Dirac.
Exactly.
If, on the other hand, the neutrinoless double beta decay experiments run into an unlucky cancellation of the three phases, they could have no evidence. And then if you find that it's not Dirac, and they find it's not Majorana,
I cannot say. I haven't thought about that. So all I can tell you is that this is the most cosmology can tell you. So I don't think I can help in that case. I can only help if I can tell them if it is a Dirac. If nature has been unkind to us that there is a cancellation of the phases, then I cannot say anything.
I've never seen that before, but that's very beautiful.
Yes, because, but I need things like Jan has, like LSST or something. I need large surveys to actually do that. So put me in the agenda for the next 5 years. 2020 is something, I'll be back.
Any other questions? Okay, let's
take it. I have one more.
Sure.
The observation announced this morning.
Yes.
Does that have any implication for experiments like LIGO?
Not for LIGO, but for LISA. So these are very small frequencies, so you need astronomical unit distances to measure the gravitational wave. So, but it does, because now we know the gravitational waves should be there, right? Then we know where to look for them, because the problem before was that, sure, I asked you $3 billion, but I have no idea where the signal is going to be. Now I know what it is. I know exactly the frequency and the level. And I know what kind of LISA, or ELISA, as it is called now. That's it. Absolutely, great implication. LIGO will measure the astrophysical sources. But the cosmological background, you measure it with ELISA. You have to go to space. And then you measure it. But yeah, great implications.
Okay, thanks.